Please welcome our moderator. He's an international expert in the field of technological and vocational education and training. He is ORT Israel's Senior Deputy Director for Research, Development and Training, Dr. Eli Eisenberg.
Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Startup Nation, Startup Education, this panel is going to be the startup panel. No video clips, no HD presentations, no simulations, no animations, no technology. Just talking and listening. The future of the next generation of conferences. A traditional, indigenous, low-tech panel. It is my great pleasure to welcome first the Excellency Lars Faaborg-Andersen, the European Union Ambassador to Israel. Ambassador Faaborg-Andersen has had a distinguished career spanning almost 30 years in the Danish Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Middle East issues appeared regularly on his agenda, and he also served as a permanent representative of Denmark to the Political and Security Committee of the European Union in Brussels. Please welcome Ambassador Faaborg-Andersen to give us a short introduction.
Professor Eisenberg, ladies and gentlemen, honored guests, it's a real pleasure for me to open this session on bridging the gap between education systems and the future labor market. This is, of course, a subject of great concern to educators and policymakers around the world. We are all, or almost all of us, facing a skills deficit. This deficit, it is important to remember, has not only economic but also social implications. It's no longer sufficient for a country to have a human capital development policy. We must look for ways to ensure better lives for individuals and for society. In a world, we should look for well-being. We must recognize that we are living in a rapidly changing world where many skills acquired today will no longer be relevant tomorrow. So, our most important task is to prepare not only our youth, but also all working people with the capabilities to constantly adapt their skills to keep pace with the evolving working place. We must also strive for a fully integrative approach that addresses the needs of all levels of society in order to avoid a situation in which there is a thin layer at the top of highly skilled workers and a wide gap in the middle and a large pool of unskilled workers at the bottom who find themselves in a precarious situation as the world around them changes. I believe that further cooperation between Israel and the EU and its member states could bring added value to the social and economic transformation in the benefit of our citizens' well-being, which is so necessary. Currently, the European Union is in the process of negotiating a twinning project on the establishment of a national qualifications framework on development of Israel's human capital with the Prime Minister's office, which as a very important component has a vocational training element. Also, as we speak, the European Union delegation in Tel Aviv is hosting the first Arab Haredi Business Corporation Conference, bringing together the business elites of those two very important and expanding communities here in Israel. These are two communities that are not very often in communication, but which may have much more to share in terms of objectives and aspirations that may meet the eye. At least we see it as a first step in a direction of further negotiation and further exchange of experience and best practices between these two communities, also in the field of skills development. Also, as you know, the European Union is contributing to the development of skills, of science, of technology in this country by being the largest public funder of research with the Horizon 2020 program, in which Israel is an extremely important and very successful participant. Just under the new Horizon 2020 program, which started a couple of years ago, Israel has received over 300 million euros in contracts so far. And if you are to live up to your previous standard, you will be taking 1.6 shekels out of this program for every shekel you put into it. The Horizon 2020 program being the world's biggest research program to the tune of some 80 billion euros over a 7-year period. So, indeed, the European Union cares, it's ready to assist, and it's ready to engage with Israel, and we continue and look forward to do that also in the years to come. I wish you a very productive discussion in the panel, which is about to start, and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ambassador Faaborg-Andersen, and it gives me the greatest pleasure to welcome now and to call upon our panelists, Dr. Madlen Şerban, please, Dr. Professor Marc de Vries, and Dr. Idit, Harel, please come to the stage. The role of our session is to discuss the challenges of how to bridge the gap between the education system and the future labor market. I just want to give you some examples. In Spain, between the age of 25 and 35, there is an unemployment of 35%. In Greece, in Egypt, in many countries, because there is a big gap, the mismatch between the education system and the labor market. We are educating and training the generation of the future, trying to prepare our graduates for the 21st century. So the first question, the first challenge we are going to face is, what are the main gaps and what are their implications? I would like to start with Dr. Madlen Şerban. I will introduce her. She has been the director of the ETF, European Training Foundation, since 2009 until now. Before that, she was national director of technological and vocational education and training in Romania. Dr. Şerban has broad international experience in organizations including UNESCO, USAID, the European Commission, OECD, the World Bank, and many more. Dr. Şerban, please give your response. What are the main gaps and what are the implications?
So first of all, let me thank you very much and say good morning to everyone here. It's a privilege for ETF, the EU agency, to be here and share the experience, as we are working also in global Europe. So we try to contribute to this discussion with our modest experience in this case. We are first of all observing that there is a gap in what we teach, in the way how we teach. And this is valid in the majority of the countries, unfortunately. I just mentioned, Dr. Eisenberg, which are the results of these gaps. When I'm referring to the what we teach, I think that first of all, also visiting your schools, but visiting also schools outside of Israel, we are observing that we are teaching people, the young people, what they already know, and we don't teach what they would like to learn from the schools. And I think as well there is another gap in what is it about what should they learn. And here is about a gap in between individuals and society. So then, first of all, we have to empower our citizens, not for today, but for tomorrow. And empowering them for tomorrow means that we have to teach those competencies that we are using to name them as being a collection of knowledge, skills, attitudes, and values that are becoming the best predictors to be resilient in the sense of adapting and to be innovative in the sense of being capable to anticipate. You see, I'm already anticipating something that is on the back, and you are not surprised with that. So then, first of all, individuals should be capable to have this capacity of adapting. But second, it's equally important, as the ambassador of the EU here said, is that we have to go beyond the economic narrative, and we have to empower people for the well-being. How do we define the well-being? The well-being goes beyond, as you just said, economic capital, natural capital. It's about human being, human capital, intellectual capital, cultural capital, social capital. And in all these complex environment, we have to make sure that we are capable to empower for the future societies. And the future societies, they have to have an answer to what is it, the future of work. And if we are referring to the future of work, we have to think to what today we are already observing, and this is what is happening in the reality of your schools already, in the art schools, and not only that. We see that it's a lot about being capable to use drones for connecting, no? I mean, sending medicines to the rural remote areas. This is something that I never learned in my school. I mean, it's a different reality. I mean, are we capable to do that? So then the gap, the third gap that I want to mention here, it's about how we teach. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. I would like now to introduce Professor Marc de Vries. He's also a very good friend of me. He's a professor from Delft University, Vest University of Technology in the Netherlands. Professor de Vries is editor-in-chief of the International Journal of Technology and Design Education and many other journals, and also published many books. But I first met him in South Africa when he initiated and now subsequent 32-time leader of the PET conference. PET conference stands for Pupils' Attitudes Toward Technology. The pupils are the main goal. They are our clients. And I was very astonished by the name of this conference. I wish him many more PET conferences. And for us, as I esteem, I would like to have at least 32 conferences ahead. Now I would like you to comment of what Madlen said, and maybe you should also give us some notion about the restrictions we have to make this gap smaller than it is now.
Yes, thank you so much. Is it working?
Yep. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Eddie. I'm very happy to be here and see you again. I think there's a couple of problems with education, the content of education. So I'd like to continue on what you said. And actually, I can explain that by using this wonderful acronym that you have now for ISTEAM, because all of these characters in it have their own problems. There's science education, but we know that science education has a problem of its image. In principle, it is seen as a very high-level subject. It's a requirement for most students to enter university. But if you look at numbers of what does it really result in, the striking thing is that those countries that have the highest scores on PISA and TIMSS at the same time have the lowest scores in interest in science. So what science education does apparently is just learning pupils how to jump through the hoop to give the right answers. And the whole excitement of science doesn't reach them. So this is a problem for science. Then we have technology education, which many countries have nowadays, but has very low status, merged out of craft education. So it is seen as a sort of a below-the-line subject. There's art education, but that is until now focused very much on statics. Mathematics education has its own problems, and that's particularly in the transfer of mathematical knowledge to science. There's a big problem there because pupils have seen a graph in mathematics education, and then they don't recognize it when it's used in a different way in science. So all of these different subjects all have their own problems. And then there's the E in STEAM that doesn't exist yet. There is no engineering education, no pre-university engineering education at all. One of the major problems also is that they are unconnected. They're taught in separate schools. And all I'm saying now does not hold for the art schools, because they are doing a wonderful job already for many years. And it's pretty, because always when I come here, I always get to see the best. So I'm not sure how it is in other schools in Israel, but I can imagine that it's not so much different from the schools that we have also in the Netherlands and in many other countries, where all these problems that I mentioned now are very much present. So, finally, what the greatest lack perhaps is that in these subjects there is no reference to innovation as the process that connects them. And that, I think, is the major restriction that we put us on ourselves, that we have these separate subjects, unconnected, not related to innovation, and that is why pupils really miss the opportunity to get excited by this idea of innovation.
Thank you very, very much, Marc. I truly agree with you that nobody of the pupils, even in Israel, are being evaluated or examined for innovation or for, as you say, the interdisciplinary subject. We still teach in silos, we still teach subjects. And now it's, I would like to introduce Dr. Idit, Harel, Israeli-American entrepreneur, inventor and CEO of education technology startups. The daughter of educators, like myself. Sometimes I think it's in our genes. And also, Dr. Harel is a proud alumna of Tel Aviv University and also the Harvard Graduate School of Education and the MIT Media Lab, believing that computer programming is a new literacy. Idit founded the digital learning platform called Globaloria, which has made proven strides in STEM and improves creative and critical thinking. Dr. Idit Harel, please.
Thank you. I'm delighted to be here at this first international startup education conference. And everything we heard since last night made me so jealous and feel that I really had an inadequate education, not going to ORT when I grew up, and went to just a regular high school in my neighborhood. And it's not like my parents didn't think about it, because they sent my older brother to an engineering school, the wrong one, at Tel Aviv University, obviously. But I once, when I discovered the world of computer science, engineering, design, and innovation, when I went to Harvard Graduate School of Education and I heard Seymour Papert and Marvin Minsky, Nicholas Negaponte for the first time in the early mid 80s, I came home and I was questioning that. Why wasn't I sent to an engineering school to study computer science in the 70s when I went to high school here in Israel? That needs to change. So we can actually imagine that we all learn how to read and write, but if we only how to read and we didn't know how to write, we would not be considered literate. We all use games technology from 6 months old. We're all growing up now with technology and devices all around us. We play games, we look for information, but I think we're not literate until we learn how to write these apps. Until we really understand what makes a good app, a good system, a good tool. Until we at least know how to write some code. Now, not all of us are learning creative writing and become authors and publishers and poets and writers of journalism and research reports. But we all learn how to write because it enhanced our reading capabilities. And the more we read, the better writers we become. It's the same thing now with technology. We all should have access to the creative writing, computer programming, computer science, engineering, and design thinking as a mindset for innovation, for the knowledge innovation economy, because that's what the future needs. And so if we will not know how to write it, make it, construct it, we're actually not literate. So I really believe, to be provocative here, that computer science, engineering, design thinking, innovation mindset, it's probably a human right. And if we're not providing it equally to every single child from preschool to 12th grade, we're actually depriving them from mastery of the new literacy.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Edith. And now I would like to go to a greater challenge. Give me one solution. What should we do in order to bridge the gap, in order to have a better generation of the future? The children are waiting for us, and we see a lot of obstacles, and therefore we need your advice. What should we do? Madlen, first.
Well, thank you very much. I think that you already expressed a choice, and I'm going to share with you here a secret. It's just in between you and me. Next week, we are going to organize in Europe the European Week for Vocational Skills. This is also because of what has been said here. Because of the reputation of science and technology, unfortunately, we are not managing to be enough attractive and to indicate with what we are providing that we can offer a solution to the citizens. And the ETF proposed to the Commission, European Commission, a good practice that we selected since its phase of being a pilot for Israel. And this is the iSTEAM project. This is going to be the ETF award for entrepreneurship. So that we really trust, we are visionary maybe together. Thank you very much. Well, I would like also to say that, as you know, we are your friends because we are critical friends. What we are really wanted immediately to add is that we suggest everyone to look to this good practice, understand in which context works, in which context gives results, and to consider as well the capability to think to science and technology beyond higher education, which we think till today it has been a mistake. Computer science, science and technology is not for 18 years old. It is from, I would say, almost newborn people. They are living in different societies. We strongly also believe that here is about not pretending that schools, teachers and textbooks are representing the whole reality, and therefore we have to change the way we teach and empower the citizens to be capable to navigate unfamiliar contexts. And as you rightly said, all of you here, it's about all. And this is not an ethical message, because there is an adverse impact of not involving all, and this has social cohesion but also economical consequences. And we are very, I would say, respectful to the initiative that you have in this country and many others, like Turkey here sitting in front of me, and very grateful to have another partner country with us here as well. And I think that's all. Go for iSTEAM, which is equal to eSTEAM. Be esteemed for what you do. Make sure that it's for everyone. Give the chance to individuals. And don't forget, teachers, they are not obliged to know what you think. Empower them to be capable to do that. That's what we think.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Marc, please.
Yes, well, it's logical from what I said before that my answer would be to connect the different subjects and realizing that each of them has its own value and its own character. Of course, science is a powerful way of understanding the world. Technology is a powerful way of changing the world, but they are connected. In order to change the world, you often have to get to know the world first and understand it. And that's also how it works in industry, for instance. I had the privilege of writing a book about the history of one of the major research facilities in the world, namely the Philips Research Laboratories. I talked to people there, and often they couldn't even tell whether they were scientists or engineers. They were doing it all at the same time. And that they were excited about that. And that is what people should be able to understand. So I've made a plea many times already not to talk about STEM, but talk about R&D education. So really take the innovation process as the nucleus. I think the challenge will be to find projects in which the science is really necessary to make a good design. Sometimes I see STEM projects and then the science is brought in a sort of artificial way. So pupils do an experiment, but they already knew how the design would look like. So they see it as a sort of detour and they do it, of course, teacher says so, but it doesn't really give them a better design. And so I think the challenge is to, that's a pedagogical challenge, to find projects in which they are really connected in a natural way. And the reward of that, I would think, is that pupils will really get excited about this, because I believe that the first thing of science and technology is not so much their relevance, it is of course, but the first thing that you will experience is excitement, that it is fun to get to know the reality, that it is exciting to change things and see that successfully happen. One thing I would like to make as sort of recommendation is when you do iSTEAM also to include ethics. Ethics is not there to spoil the party. Ethics is there to make sure that your technology will do what you want it to do. So really take care that you also have moral considerations building in these projects so that pupils really consider the kind of values that you want to go for, like peace, like prosperity, like, well, I've seen a wonderful project here with biomimicry. We also use nature as an inspiration. So that would be something that I would really like to give as a recommendation. And finally, I'd like to end up with a small example of innovation. Sometimes the conferences also give you an opportunity for that. You mentioned PET already. Last PET conference we had a little gadget, and that is wearable proceedings. Have you ever heard of that? Wearable proceedings. Well, here it is. The proceedings of the PET conference on a bracelet. So as a token of appreciation, I'd like to give this little piece of innovation, wearable proceedings, to you, Elias.
Thank you very much. What you say, you exhibit already. Thank you. And now to Idit, please.
Thank you. So to follow these key ideas that you were presenting here, I founded a company, you asked about solutions, to really model the solution. I think what we've seen with ORT iSTEAM is very important. It's project-based learning that is actually being applied to a lot of subjects and topics that are being learned in the school, including the humanities and the arts, as well as, of course, science and mathematics. And I think the important thing to remember is that starting in preschool years, all the way to 12th grade, the role is to really teach children thinking. It really is about learning how to learn with technology to increase our own ability to construct, to invent, to create, and to be able to ask big questions, do research, build prototypes, and learn how to code. Coding is just a little piece of the computer scientists, of the robotics engineer, of the artificial intelligence inventor, data systems thinker. It's just a small piece. We cannot just bring coding and say, check. Right? So what iSTEAM is emphasizing is very much along the lines, and it's incredible that already 200 institutions and 100,000 students are engaged in this way. So with Globaloria, we actually made an effort to bring computer science and design thinking, software engineering, and coding into any pathway and any subject in a school, starting in pre-K all the way to 12th grade. We realized that there are very few, probably similar to Israel, there are very few computer science certified teachers in the United States. In Texas, for example, 5.5 million students, only 600 computer science certified teachers. So we redesigned the solution after years of research to make sure that we are able to pay a lot of attention to loving and training the teachers and the principals. This year, for example, we've trained 400 teachers. We're in 250 schools with 20,000 students that are going through the program. Some of them are history teachers. Some of them are literature teachers, Spanish language teachers, as well as math teachers and digital computer game design and computer science teachers. So we can actually integrate computer science and apply it to lessons that teachers need to cover according to their standards if they teach American history or World War II, if they teach pieces of literature in the humanities and English language arts, or if they teach numeracy, algebra, calculus, or chemistry 101, as well as computer science track for AP computer science. And I think that's really where the world is heading. Every teacher should be trained according to Globaloria, and we have proven that we can do it. Every teacher can be trained in 3 days to actually integrate according to the standards that they need to cover for the subject matter that they're already experts in, to apply computer science in their classes so the students can develop an app, a simulation, or a game, an educational game, to teach the topic that the teachers are actually wanting the students to master. And what we discovered in our research, that it's pretty amazing versus control groups, that the students that learned computer science or programming in isolation in a computer lab just for the sake of learning how to code are not really at the same level as the students who were learning it integrated and applied with the subject matter that they're learning. Also, the students who were learning, say, mathematics in isolation without the integration of the computer science, such as creating a game to teach fractions or explaining climate change and greenhouse gases or the life cycle of the cell in advanced biology, the students who were actually creating the application did better on the test, not because they were prepared for the test in some drill and practice, just because they learned how to think about the major questions, the misconceptions, and explain it and build projects that are explaining content and the mastery of the computer science and the programming and the design thinking that is happening along the way. So number one, all teachers should be trained, not just the technology teachers, not just the STEM teachers, all principals should be trained because they never really studied it. So we need to bring that new literacy to everyone in the system. And then people should be encouraged to create projects in the classes, including the most advanced technology and computer science pathways.
Thank you very much, Edith. Allow me now to conclude this session by saying that I truly believe that the education system plays a great role in preparing the next generation for the world of the future. However, we must cooperate, join forces, working together with outside communities, starting with the parents, universities, colleges, industries, businesses, research institutions, and more, in order for our schools to be much more relevant, much more meaningful for our students. We must work collectively and move from an ego system to an ecosystem. I thank our panelists. I thank you all. Thank you. רשת אורט ישראל, סטארט-אפ אדיוקיישן. לפרטים נוספים, היכנסו לאתר.